Hello and welcome to Today the News of Angela Life. My name is Precious Chukwudi and Damilola Ogunchakwu. How are you, Dami?
I'm very fine.
Preparing for the new year. I mean, we're trying to get our new year resolution and also get my wishes and visions. I have to put it in order.
People say this every time it's a new year. People keep saying new year, new me. Which new year?
It's the same you, but the only thing is, you know, yesterday I talked about it in one of my shows that time, you know. You have to really prepare for it and you have to change your character. I mean, if you think that there's a certain character that you portrayed this year and it didn't work out for you, I mean, you need to change it next year. But we see people saying new year, new me, but still they go back to the same people they are. So it's like they're not able to differentiate. You know, then I was talking about statistics that says that 80% of the world people, by February, they forget about their vision, their New Year resolutions, the new me agenda. They forget about it and just go back to the normal thing. I mean, that's how it is for many people.
All right, let's just move straight to the dailies this morning. We'll be starting off with Vanguard. The main story says that Governor Makinde raises alarm at bandits from Mali coming to Nigeria through Shaki borders. The writer says meets Okeogun royal fathers. Urges Shaki residents to be vigilant, says if they gain entrance or bricks, they will stay. We have stories about State of the Nation. Stop blaming God for Nigerian's woes, Obasanjo tells leaders. You can see that on page 11. On page 9, NIMSI adopts a booking system for NIN enrollment. Find out more about that on Vanguard papers. And on page 5, I didn't call for coup. I spoke based on evidence. Bishop Kuka is saying that on page 5. On page 12, Edo governor dispute. INEC tenders of Obaseki's nomination form in evidence. And on page 6, troops kill 15 bandits in Kaduna Abuja Road Casina. Okay, that's a very sad story. On page 8, COVID-19. January will be tough. Federal government confiscates a passport of 100 test defaulters. FCT threatens to shut markets, malls. Cooperate with government on crossover night service. Can saying that one. NMA attributes second wave to poor adherence to guideline. On page 13, Ohanaeze leadership. Massive urges peace as groups allege imposition. They're away from Vanguard, move straight to the Punch newspaper.
And on the front page of the Punch newspaper, we have a federal government adopting wrong strategies to address bad economy. That's coming from Obasanjo, Utomi, and others. Don't blame God for Nigeria's woes, Obasanjo tells a nation's leader. We are facing hunger, insurgent dislodging farmers, says Milafia. Also, I'll fight food inflation in 2021, oil industry in turmoil, and that's coming from President Muhammadu Buhari. And you can see the stories on page 2. Now, moving on to the stories below, we have complying with directive on crossover service. Christian Association of Nigeria tells churches, also gunmen in army uniform adopt Oyo farmer. January will be tough, spike in COVID-19 infections imminent. That's coming from NCDC. You can see that on the page 15. Our stories above the nameplate. Kuka says, I never call for a coup against Buhari. Firms grown as ministry delays the expatriate quota approval. You can see that on page 21. Lastly, on the front page of the Punch newspaper, Buhari to sign 2021 budget on Thursday, and that's all we have on that. From the Punch newspaper, we'll go straight to the Nation newspaper.
And on the Nation newspaper, the main story says, COVID-19, lack of oxygen, bed space hampers treatment. The writer says, can RCCG, Winners Chapel, back down on crossover service. We have on page 5, community policing begins in Kaduna, Kebbi, Sokoto with 975 corps. And also we have a NIMSI adopts a booking system for NIN enrollment. You can see that on page 26. And lastly on the front page of the Nation, we have a 2015 audit report. Ministry paid 968 million naira without approval. That's huge. You can see that on page 8. And that's all we can take on the front pages of the dailies this morning. We're moving on to the newspaper analysis. We'll be joined in by our guest. Stay with us after this break. We'll be right back. Face total shutdown nationwide. See page 5.
She overwhelmed by security challenges.
Hello and welcome to Today the News on Vanguard. Here on Today the News, we read and give in-depth analysis on some of the stories on the front pages of the paper. Also take your insightful comments on what's going on here in Nigeria and across the world. Join us Monday through to Friday
on Vanguard Live.
Alright, welcome back. Just joining us is still Today the News on Vanguard Live. My name is Precious Chukudi and
Damla Chaki.
And you're welcome to the newspaper analysis segment. We're joined by our guest via Zoom. He's in the person of Mr. Gbenro Oladipe. He's the executive director of Emergency and Risk Alert. Good morning, Mr. Gbenro.
Good morning. How are you?
Very well. Good to have you join us this morning. All right, let's just move ahead and then talk about what the papers are talking about this morning. And it's the fact that, you know, Governor Seyi Makinde, he mentioned that bandits are, you know, making efforts into getting into Nigeria through the Shaki international borders. Now, my question is, are borders that porous for bandits to make entries?
Yes. I listened to Governor Seyi Makinde. I think of a fact, Shaki area is contiguous to other West African countries, but that is not enough to enough alibi for what is going on in Nigeria. We have said this several times that there is need for strategic digital border management in order to ward off this attack and this intrusion. Nigeria is tired of who is causing the problem. The problem, the fact is that we have elected people to solve problems, and the problems must be solved. We don't want to know whether they are coming from Mali, from Niger, from Dahomey, from wherever. The fact is that people should sit tight, address issues, solve problems, and advance progress. That is the whole essence of electing leaders, electing rulers, and not to be looking at how we are going to look for a fall boy or a fall girl among the sub-regional countries of West Africa or even beyond, continental countries in the continent. It is given that when you are given responsibility, you should scale up to the responsibility of prevention of illegal people intruding into your country, responsibility of securing your people internally. That cannot be abridged by excuses of people coming from Mali, people coming from Niger, people coming from Benin Republic and all manner of things. As a matter of fact, I really don't know why, because there is a problem in Mali, that we should be feasting on the problem of Mali as if we had no problem before Mali. So the problem of Nigeria is national, but it has international dimension. But then, how are we even reacting and solving the problem, the national problems that we have? That is part of our problem. If we're able to address our national problem, build consensus on how our states should operate, and of course, international problem can easily be solved. It's just like the Yoruba proverb is that if you take care of the home, of course, you 90% you have taken care of 90% of external problems. We have problems at home, and if there is no cleavage, if there is no allies within, the problems we are outside is not going to fester. The fact is that Boko Haram is homegrown. It started in Nigeria. It doesn't matter whether they are extending out of the infernal hand of comradeship to other terror groups across the border.
All right.
That is not the issue. We must solve the internal problem. Therefore, we should not begin to externalize our problem and feel relaxed. And all this manner that is not empirical deductive in terms of research, in terms of contextualizing issue, it's not going to bring problems. Problem-solving conditions to our land.
All right, speaking about our allies, I remember when we had the incident with the 43 farmers that were killed, one of the statements that came out from the Boko Haram at that time was that this is just one of the things that will be happening, that people who will be giving intelligence information to, you know, the government, they are going to get more of this kind of attack. Now the question is, how can we, you know, get the government, you know, to get united with people to get intelligent information from them when things like this occur?
You listen to Ndume the other time. Our strategy for engaging Boko Haram is faulty. Our strategy for engaging terrorism is extremely faulty. I really don't know a country that will be de-radicalizing when the war is still raging. These are post-terror management of issues that you are doing within the context of raging terror by saying that you are de-radicalizing, and then the so-called de-radicalized people, you reintegrate them into society. And it has been alluded to by Senator Ndume that these are the people giving even information to their former colleague or manifest colleague in the jungle called Sambisa Forest, which are Boko Haram adherents. So I think our whole approach to tackling the problem is very, very wrong in terms of looking for source of funding, where the funding is coming from. Look, the gadgets and equipment that these guys are using, they are not the one me and you can go to market and purchase. The type of network they have built over the year is not easy to dismantle, but we are not doing anything about that. And even the least that we can do, some people that are in ID camp, you are not taking care of them properly. And let me tell you the implication of that. If they are so decimated, and they see that they have been displayed, and they had what well-founded fear of moving to IDP camps, and you are not taking care of them, then they become a very veritable recruitment pool for Boko Haram. So these are challenges we are having. We are not managing anyone well.
Okay, Mr. Gwero, you talked about the IDP camp now. These are issues that people have been facing for a long time. You know, many people have been against the idea of taking these people to IDP camp. But you say that they need to take care of them more. What are you trying? I would like you to expatiate more on that.
Hello?
Mr. Gwero,
yes. When people... Yes, what I mean is this. When people are displaced from their habitual residence, due to well-founded fear of persecution, in this case, being persecuted by Boko Haram, the onus is on the state to ensure that they are not treated below human standard. The fact that they are displaced does not make them subhuman. In essence, access to almost everything they had in their habitual residence should be provided in terms of feeding, in terms of education in emergency, in importance of ensuring that ensuring application of psychosocial therapy in terms of grief management, all this should come in a bundles in order to respond to the issues of displaced persons. And we are not doing this, and to add insult to injury, those that caused the trigger their displacement, that maim and kill their people, kill their wives, husbands, and children, you are reintegrating them back, and you are supporting them with resources that should ordinarily be going to this displaced person. What do you want them to think? Is it not, if you are to take a qualitative assessment of that, is it not obvious that it seems better to be in the terror group than to be in IDP camp?
Okay,
these are challenges. But as much as possible, decimate the recruitment pool of Boko Haram. And that is one way, one of the ways we can decimate it, so that it does not look attractive for people to go and join them. And then you look at issues of human security in terms of employment, in terms of, okay, if people have been displaced, they have no access to land, they have no access to resources. If they were farmer before, what is that telling you? In a strange land, we should be looking for alternative occupation for them. Alternative occupation, because they cannot have access to land, most of them are not likely to be farmer. And if they are not farmer, and if they are not doing anything, they are likely to be idle, and when they are idle, they become devil's workshop. When they become devil's workshop, ministration of terror, luring them into their own side, become very easy. So okay, we are talking of evangelism of terror by Boko Haram is made easy by incompetent response, incompetent appropriate response to issue of displacement and to all damages that have been caused by
I have to cut in there. So, you know, it seems, there's a word that, you know, many Nigerians have actually been saying on social media. They've been saying a lot. And it seems the former president, that's Olusegun Obasanjo, finally brought it out from the people's mouths. Or should I just say, he just said it. And that was yesterday. He said that the president crop of Nigerians leaders need to stop blaming God for the country's woes, but rather they should blame themselves. And he also insisted that God did not create Nigeria to be poor, but the bad decision of Nigeria's leaders had left the country in its current bad situation. And he said, you know, Nigeria does not deserve to be poor, that no Nigerians need to go to bed hungry. Now, this statement coming from the former president of Nigeria, it's what I would like you to react to, you know, as a former president himself, that, you know, some people have been talking about that, you know, he might have been the one to start this, or he might have solution, you know, to this whole thing on ground. I would like you to react to that.
Let me tell us one thing about what is most tragic about Nigeria in search for solution. Emotionalization of your problem will not get you out of that problem. We like to emotionalize our problem, and in the course of that, we lose answer, appropriate answer, or we fail to face the problem squarely. God has nothing to do with challenges in Nigeria. They are self-implicated. In fact, I have said that if God does not actually judge Nigeria the way we are, then God should actually apologize to Sodom and Gomorrah, because we have offended God himself in terms of oppression, in terms of corruption, in terms of killing and destroying and decimating and actually violating every law of humanity in our lands. We spill blood every day, and we have government in place who should be responding to that, limiting the liberty of the lawless, checkmating terror and the terror gang and groups. And this government is aloof, handing over every issue to God, because Nigeria has become a one religious bigot's basket. So everything that we do now, even the one that God has ceded to us as human beings, I used to say, and I've said this several times, I don't know whether on this platform, that when God created heaven and earth, God himself said that he has handed over heart to children of men. So when God created Garden of Eden and put Adam and Eve there, was it God that was stealing the ground for them?
All
was
right,
it God that put down and waited for them? Nigeria, we have phony leaders who wants to abdicate their responsibility. And more tragic, we have phony citizens who embraced all sorts of nonsense from their leaders, rather than putting them under the burden of accountability. We continue to excuse their non-performance and poor performance and hanging everything on the doorstep of God that did not send us to be killing ourselves, did not send people to be stealing, did not send people to be oppressing others, taking children out of school, not caring about their society, and cumulatively becoming a society of death and disaster.
All right, Mr.
So where is the word of God in this?
Yeah, you know, I'm sure you would have seen what's been going on social media with Bishop Kuka's Christmas message, where he berated the state of the nation and said Nigeria was heading towards a failed state. Now, do you find anything wrong with his Christmas message?
In fact, that Christmas Kuka's message is a reflection of Nigeria's tragic trajectory. So there is nothing there. The message was contextual. The message was factual. The message was responsible. The least the government can do is not to pejorate the message like the information minister is doing. He didn't call for coup anywhere. He's making an analogy that if this one is not Muslim Hausa Fulani that is in power, that coup will have happened yesterday. Look, all things that tomorrow we make it 37 years that President Buhari led a coup that ended the Second Republic. In Buhari's statement, he alluded to everything that Kuka said in his statement as a reason for him to take in over the government 37 years ago. I'm talking of a democratic government put in place by the Nigerian people in the Second Republic under the leadership of Alhaji Shehu Shagari was violently toppled by Muhammadu Buhari led junta. So in the statement of Buhari as the reason for the coup, he alluded to everything that Kuka has said. So nothing has changed. That is what Kuka is saying. And we have a government that should have changed the dynamics. Look at the issues in Kuka's message. He's talking of a lopsided appointment. All security chiefs in Nigeria are from the north. Is it chief of army staff? Is it chief of air staff you want to talk of? All of them, is it paramilitary? Is it a civil defense you want to talk? Is it police you want to talk? Is it a custom, immigration? They are from the north. And what are we here saying? Emotionalizing irresponsible appointment. Appointment that should be used to galvanize a consensus for national integration. You decimated it and you put your own tribe person there.
All right,
what is bad is that nepotism and this thing. And that is, the fallout is what we are getting. The fallout is that there is least cooperation. People are not rallying around any solution or policy instrument that Buhari wants to wait. That is just the issue. And that is, look, the best you can take out of Kuka's message is to reflect on the message. Make amendments. Yeah. Accept your error and let the nation move forward in unity.
You know, one of the, you know, thoughts and, you know, talks of people has been that religious leaders should stop getting themselves involved with politics. But now my question is, should religious leaders not be able to speak, not be allowed to speak their truth to those at the helms of affairs without fear or favor? Should they not be allowed to speak their truth?
Being a religious leader, does he abolish your citizenship? As a religious leader, does he abolish your citizenship? We are talking of oppression. Let me tell us, for those of us who are even Christian, the fact is that the whole history of Jesus is to come and decimate oppression. When people are placed under the yoke of sin, Jesus came to die, to liberate human race. That is the whole essence of religion. I don't know what his policies in speaking against oppression, against injustice. Of course, if you look at the book of Amos, he's saying that let justice roll down like a gushing and rushing waters. I'm quoting from the Bible, not even from any man of God. So the issue of humanity is weightier than what can be left in the hands of politicians. The issue of nation building cannot be entrusted on the issue of politicians alone. In fact, if you look at the history of state, it is interwoven with the history of religion. Is it the history of Charlemagne and Italy, in Italy? Is it the history of American Martin Luther that you want to talk that you will not find the religion coming into the states affair there? Is it in the Bible where prophets are not speaking to kings and kingdoms? As a matter of fact, Prophet Samuel in the Bible said when he touched when Saul touched torn his clothes, he said his kingdom has been torn too. So what part of that are we talking? It's just what they want people to do. It's for religious, because they know Nigeria are extremely and gullibly religious. They want people, a religious leader, that will induce their worshippers with docility so that they become impotent in challenging government, in challenging ungodly and unpopular policies. That is what they want. That cannot be found in the Bible that I have read well. I may not be able to say, but only any other one. But then I'm sure, as some of my Muslim friends don't allude to what they are saying. They are looking for escape route to abdicate responsibility, and they begin to dance. Look, being a religious leader does not strip you of your right, your citizenship right, the right to talk, to enjoy your right under the Nigerian Constitution. Assuming that a religious leader commits crime now, would they arrest him under Nigerian law? That means that you should obey Nigerian law. That means that you should surrender to Nigerian Constitution. And under Chapter 4 of Nigerian Constitution, which encapsulates your fundamental human rights, you have freedom to your opinion, to your thought, freedom of speech, freedom of life, and so freedom encapsulated in the Constitution. So it's only when they want to be brutally deceptive that they continue to ask you, nobody should play whether they call it politics, that is their problem. The whole essence of life is politics. Like Aristotle have said, man is a political animal. And when he was saying that, he did not distinguish, and man has no different species. We are all political animal. And pastors, imams, and religious leaders are included. And they should not be excluded from the affairs of their countries in terms of their contributions. Anyway.
Okay, it's good to see that you went back to Aristotle's words, but let's talk about the health sector now, right now, and COVID. Currently, we're talking about COVID daily increasing, and it seems the Director General of NCDC, that's Dr. Chiku Ekwueze, said that in terms of the new variant of the virus, that there's no change in presentation of symptoms, except that it's more transmissible. Right now in Nigeria, many people don't really know, you know, if it's the new variant of COVID-19 that is in, or, you know, the one that people really know about. But federal government also said that, you know, that January 2021 would be tough in terms of managing the COVID-19 pandemic due to people not really following, you know, the safety guidelines. I mean, this word now that January 2020 will be tough. It's not what people want to hear, saying that it's just few hours, you know, to a new year. Now, with what he's saying, I would like you to really react to that. What do you think this means for Nigerians in terms of, you know, the health sector?
There we go again. The problem is that are they managing the second strand of COVID outbreak well? That is the issue. I have said it. Look, you have a problem. You reflect on the problem. And you have come out with what? That this new variant of COVID originates from United Kingdom and it has gotten to South Africa. What are you expected to do as a country? Even countries in Europe, even countries in America, they are already preventing entrance from UK into their country. Now you keep our borders open and you are provocating within the thing. Look, you have identified where the strand is. In order to limit the damage, one thing that you have to do, there must be travel restriction from those areas. And it's not issue that you postpone. If you have no ulterior motive of waiting for your own children or everything to enjoy flight back, the issue of emergency is addressed with the speed of time, with the speed of responsibility, and also with the speed of appropriateness. What should have been done is to short airspace between Nigeria and the United Kingdom, where you have confirmed where you say the origins of the new entrant is from. Then it will become easy for you to manage the local emergency. Then you come back home and put things in order. Now you allow them to come in and you are harassing the people at home. How are they going to believe you? And these people, including myself, as God believe it, we are not going into 2021 with any fear, with any affliction. So we have that in our mind, and it's the responsibility of government to ensure that this prayer is heard by putting measures in place, both internally and defensively. When you are, the reason for having territory is for you to be able to manage and defend your territorial integrity. And it's not only in time of war, in times of affliction like this, you defend your border. But if it is another thing now, they will be able to be respond fast. If it is to put oppression on their people, they can do that fast. Okay. How do you talk of emergency without the characteristic of speed in it, the characteristic of intelligence, understanding of the context that you have even partially done, that okay, it's coming from England. Then what have you done about England closing their access to your country and all those type of things?
Okay,
our national response is inappropriate. I have said it. Our national response is bereft of context and intelligence. So they are not driven by knowledge.
You talked about shutting down the airspace. Federal government announced its decision to confiscate 100 international passports of travelers who evaded day 7 post arrival of a PCR test. And they mentioned that the nation's health sector, health system is currently struggling to cope with the increasing number of infections daily. And we're talking about shutting down the airspace and confiscating these people's passports. I know that sometimes when it comes to these things, in a matter to cope with some of the people or trace back their step, trace them sometimes might be difficult. So confiscating their passport and shutting down the airspace, which do you think would be a better way to stop this?
I think that already in the country affecting other if they have COVID. Is that a solution? When the damage has been done, what does it matter? When the head is off, complaining headache is out of it. So if you don't do, it's just like putting the cart before the horse. The cart does not pull the horse. It's the horse that pulls the cart. We are doing things wrongly. And let me tell you, that one said, it's even biased against Nigeria. Those coming to Nigeria and are evading this thing, have they confirmed that they are Nigerians? What of if they are foreigners? How do you confiscate a passport that you have not given? Can you confiscate any other people's or invalidate other countries' even if they are Nigerians and they have valid access to the country and entrance to the country? What of if they go to Ghana to take flight back? What are you telling me? When you fail in a... Look, you are a gatekeeper when they come in. And stop complaining. Let them do the right thing. How are they getting the fake result, COVID result in the first place? Is it not the same official? So what are we telling ourselves? We are just exposing our ignorance, our stupidity to the rest of the world by even actions and by policy choices that we make. They will just, the world has moved on and has left Nigeria behind. Look at the type of solution they are offering in terms of restriction. Is that what they are doing? I have just told you there's nothing as potent as when you derive this thing, you shut the border. When you know that, then you continue to do internal management of the of response to COVID second wave, and not predicating an ideas that are obsolete and that they are not implementable, they are not even adaptable to international laws guiding travels in terms of COVID. If the person is not a Nigerian, he moves to Ghana under ECOWAS this thing.
Sorry to cut you in. Our time is fast spent. I wanted to keep talking. Thank you so much for sharing your thoughts with us this morning. That's Mr. Abiru Olajuwon, Executive Director of Emergency and Risk Alert. Thank you for joining us this morning.
It's a pleasure being with you. Thank you very much.
All right, remember that you can equally like, share, and subscribe on all our social media platforms showing on your screen. As well as you want to find out today's stories, you can go on our website, www.vanguardngr.com, to find out more. Till I come your way next time, I remain Precious Chukwudi and
Damilola Mushagi.
Thank you for watching and have a fabulous day.